The other one was, we need a more focused approach around fisheries in general. We've had that conversation before, and I think that's one of the topics that we're going to have at our strategic session, isn't it? Is that right?
Yeah.
Okay, that's good. Because we have, as a nation, we have our allocations, what we, our treaty allocations. We have good social ceremony, we have licenses that we own as a nation. We have license holders still today. But I feel that we kind of weigh too much on other side tables to carry our voice for us. And so it doesn't really reflect to me that it's a government-to-government relationship, DFO and HFN, so I just wanted to make those points that we kind of strengthen our position on that and work more closely with DFO and start to build a relationship, especially over this winter, moving in towards next season, to start basically put everything on the table in terms of what we have so we can get to what you're talking about here, Robert, you know, the resources that we need to achieve outcomes. And we've been struggling since we've signed treaty to achieve our allocations and get our fishing and use our licenses in a way where we should be using them. So a more political approach, a more political plan around that, and strategies built around that. And the comment I wanted to make around the Huntway Council is we're going to start doing that work in the very near future. Trudy is going to be working with us to help us define what kind of resources we need to achieve the work that we need to do collectively with the way. In terms of bringing more resources to the table, so we can best utilize our utmost time for the best interest of the Kuwait nation. Meaning that there's many committees that I sit on where it takes away a lot of time for me, and it gets to burnout state. So we've been 2011 till now, we've been identifying these things on we need somebody to come help us champion that work and get to a place where we can identify where our best use of our time is going to be. And how we build resources up around our Huntway Council table, recognizing, you know, where we're at today. So I just wanted to make those comments.
Thank you. Appreciate it. Yeah. So just on your number 7 in regards to appointments, I went to the last First Nation Summit event, and it seems like it's very treaty implementation oriented. So it could be something that could attest. I am wondering though, the AFN is not something that we often go to, so maybe sending them would be a good idea. Do you have someone who goes to the Union of BC Indian Chiefs?
No, I forgot I was going to put that one here.
Ben would be a good one for that too. I'm wondering as to how that would be undertaken. Is that something where we can just tap someone to go who isn't on council? Or I don't know the procedure there, but I think it's just there should be some sort of something.
I think it's more of I'm in a position to appoint anyone to council. And the reason I made Ben is that I'm recognizing we're all busy now. I have asked other people to contribute on council for 10, and they've been busy, so this is my alternative to a busy executive council.
And then, I'm uncertain as to whether or not the First Nations Leadership Council still exists, or if it does, it might be something that I'd like to go to. If not, do it here.
Yeah.
But I can take the First Nations Summit if that's directly.
Okay, you can do it. Okay. Good, thanks, Matt. Very well.
So I don't know that we need a motion yet, but I think we should perhaps ask the executive director to look into what it is we should do, if there's any procedure we should create or do to make sure that we do have the ability to send Kuwait citizens or committee members from Kapwea, or all three in some instances, to these kind of events empowered with representative.
All I'm saying is that Okay. So anyway, the emerging issues, I just wanna make sure that they're in there, and I want us to, I'd like us to have a decision that we develop an executive council communication plan. Because I think if we may find that our current communication department might be overworked there, and I don't know if that's, if we're gonna be overburdening the work, I would need that information there. And, because I know a lot of times, I've heard Heather say, we're busy now.
It kind of goes in waves.
Yeah. So anyway, I would need a decision that we do develop an executive council, communication plan.
With that communication plan, I think this falls in there. But when we go as council members to meetings with different ministers and, mostly ministers, it would be really helpful if somebody from the communications team was there at the meeting to assist the executive council member, only because what I've realized this last little bit with the communication that I've had out of the meeting with Minister Fraser, is the communication team, Heather, played a big role in that once I got back in the letter to Minister Fraser, what the content needed to look like basically the support mechanism. It probably would have been more beneficial to have her there at the meeting to be able, or somebody from the communication team that is going to be creating these documents, or these letters that go out, or somebody, some person. But it's, what happens, or what I observed this last time, is everybody that I was working with to develop this letter to go to the minister, nobody was there at the meeting. So basically, it was what I said and what they interpreted, what Elizabeth thought, what Trudy put in technically, like it wasn't somebody there that was writing the letter that was actually in the meeting or the correspondence. Do you know what?
I know what you mean. And I know what you mean, because what you're saying is critical.
Yeah.
Because this is where we're connecting the dots for that meeting, and we need to be able to. And the other thing that I know, Connie, and I'm glad you raised this, is that sometimes when you're making a presentation, it might be the morning of that you want to make a change.
Yeah.
Because something has arisen and said, it's happened to us where we've had to, you know, make a change before we went into the meeting.
Yeah.
So I support that.
Okay. But we could just make note of that in your communication.
Okay, any more discussion on the report? Doc, we'll go to the next report, which is council.
Yes. Okay, so I'll give a quick update on regional districts in regards to what's taken up time so far. So there's no sway there, there's no power. There could be a voice, but it's a visiting voice. And that's just, if we're going to do reconciliation properly for local government, at least, who Patrick said, the shot needed to be at the table with a full vote. Ideally, everyone who is ready or wants to join the regional district board should be able to, and then it's true representation of all communities. And that's been received reasonably well. The big thing that is something that is relevant to Hawaiian interests is that we don't regulate cannabis. And we may want to look at what our regulations on cannabis may look like in regards to both retail and production. And I think that there are opportunities and threats existent in those things. So that's something I'm probably going to take half an hour of our retreat on, in that we need to have a strategy to incorporate it into what it is we do, or just kind of do everything in our power to make sure it doesn't affect the community.
Yeah.
Both are valid. Communities do those things. And I have my own opinions, but right now they're pretty much only mine, so I won't talk to you about them. There are no real emergent issues other than the preeminent emergent issue for Hawaii as a whole, and that's the state of the road. And making sure that we conduct all of our points of pressure in a good way, but also in a way that produces the best result for us, not just locally, but using local apparatus to press the province from that side of things too. So the director for Banfield, Bob Beckett, has been very good at interacting with the premier, and we're identifying Ministry of Transport as being,
friend.
Yeah, as being the difficulty that it's Ministry of Transport that we need to convince, and it's and secondarily, but probably more importantly, Minister James. So we need to find ways to sit down with them. The Minister of Finance, Carol James.
Oh, okay.
So there's that. That's it for local government. From a treaty implementation perspective, starting in July into August, I've been doing what I can to catch up on understanding fish and learning to understand that it matters, to the point where you have to get into the details, and that's where I've dealt with a lot of difficulties, that the details never mattered to me and now they do. But it's a catching up process. We're also working at making sure that we can update our land use plan, zoning, and natural resource management. To make sure that we keep up with what we need to do from a regulatory standpoint, environmentally, but also allowing for actual real alternatives for economic development to exist in our territory, but also upholding preservation and conservation as tenants of what it is we need to do. It's a delicate balance, but we need to, I think, act to remove or separate out what FDEV wants from what we think we should do, because those two things need to conflict from time to time to figure out what actually falls out of it. And just some basic updates on attending the tripartite committee and the work we're doing on adding lands to TSL. I would note that it's not in my report, but I had received from you, Robert, the notion of adding additional lands to TSL outside of the pre-approved lands, and that'll take some extra work on our end before we talk to the province about it. For treaty implementation, that's something that OEA needs to look at. I have two items, one of which is evaluating whether and to what degree we want to be involved in the financial ownership side of the Trans Mountain Expansion Project, because the federal government is talking about offering some sort of financial share in the project, and that First Nations could be able to access the infrastructure level of economic benefit from it as an incentive. And I think that's something that is more in the avenue of finance. But I've taken an interest in because it's being brought up at the model level. If we can somehow remove the risk of losing money from ownership, then that might be something we may want to look into. Crown governments. So the fiscal policy update, now that the election is over, we expect the federal fiscal policy collaboration to continue. And that means that we'll continue work on updating the amounts of money that we'll be receiving in regards to infrastructure, culture, language and heritage, natural resource management, and a bunch of other categories of money. So the money that we got an increase in now is earmarked for governance. So for the conduct of our government in regards to programs and services or support for traditional processes and so on and so forth. So I expect that once we start moving through each of these different buckets of money or categories, we'll see a significant increase in funding from the federal government on that. That's going to continue. We have crackerjack people working on it, both in staff and people who've been hired. That same thing is going to happen with the province, and I do know that Connie is linked in on how that's developing as well, and that from a mono perspective will probably be involved peripherally, if not directly. We're better situated now to provide even more input on how the province fills out their policy on how the fiscal relationship works with BC and Treaty First Nations, and we can probably guide it in such a way that will maximize our benefit, but also be beneficial for all the other Mono-Auth and other Mono-Treaty nations out there too. Don't have much update on M&A. the only other thing is an update on the executive director search. That's I'm probably going to try to bring up a personnel committee call sometime early next week, whenever that works for both Tom and Trevor and others on that. And then we'll provide that update, and then we'll move ahead with the next steps. And then lastly, I'd just like to thank the speaker, the staff, and the contractors for the People's Assembly. I was super skeptical that it would be successful given my doubt of the logistics, but it really went off really well. So that's...
It blew you away.
Yeah, it did. It was great. It was, yeah, it went really well. Yeah.
Okay, John, thank you for your report. You brought them up in your report, but certainly identifying what the fishery opportunities are for 2020. Mm. I'm looking at herring. Herring, we have in the treaty 90 short tons, and right now it's for ceremony, or what do you call it? Social ceremony. And there's no way 5 tribes can eat 90 tons of herring. So, I think we should talk about having a discussion at Monos with whether we want to convert that into some of that into an economic opportunity. You know what I mean?
Yep.
And then the other one that is, Kathy, if you can get our fishery staff to get us a report about what people see the escape levels are going to be at Rita, Saksa, Kachina, and don't forget in the treaty, we have access, economic access to surplus land. So we should be on an annual basis reviewing those numbers. And, if there's a surplus opportunity, we get to fish it. So we should check into that. Sure we get that. And then thanks for the update on the treaty land, Sean. I would like to seek executive council. There's Rance Island. We should look at making that treaty land. And also the Sri Disorder. The section 2.10.23 explains that once we acquired those lands or ours, mm-hmm. we can make an application for them. But Sarita and Rance aren't on it.
Right. There's in the treaty, there's a pre-approved plans.
Yeah. And I agree with your bullet regarding the federal government, but we should also add, anything that we need to focus on that we see regarding any of those regarding fiscal policy. The only thing I wanted to be careful of, because we're a really progressive First Nations, we are getting funding from BC that other First Nations aren't getting. Mm-hmm. And I don't want us to be too aggressive where we impact the relationship. Where does things are getting to the way you're doing quite well compared to other First Nations. We got to let the other First Nations catch up. I think we're starting to. We got to weigh that. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So, and then the last comment is, in terms of LNG, I guess, is it safe, John, just to say that their timeout has been extended?
To a certain degree, yes. Yeah. So we're still on pause, and we're still waiting to hear back on any developments. But at this point, the other clock has started.
Okay. Thank you for your question. Okay. The next one was, I believe, Connie.
Yeah.
I see Councillor Goetz is blank. That means he didn't get his report.
Yes.
Huh?
That's what it means.
Okay.
First, my report is August, September. It didn't change from June in July. The information did. Not the top part, not the date. The finance, I think, I don't have to to go into any more detail of what I'm doing in finance. It pretty much explains itself through the agenda, both agendas. Children and Family Services, or Citizen Development, I always call it Children and Family Services. There's the housing is huge, as Charlie and I have started working together on, and will be getting in, up into our elbows, I guess, here pretty quick, of what is that, how we're going to make that happen. It sounds really simple, but it's a lot of work, but exciting work. And it has come up at our meeting now a couple of times, our Citizen Development Committee meeting. And so bringing the team up to speed on that. And that's basically what the team has been doing. We had a new team except for one, and bringing them up to speed on what citizen development is. We've had a loss, and so we now have to fill that seat, which I have an applicant here. I'm looking for an acceptance for Zelta Clappis to join or be appointed to the Citizen Development Committee.
Are you moving that?
Yeah.
Second?
Speak to it a little bit. I'm excited for Zelta to join the committee, because I've had a number of one-on-one conversations with her over periods of time, and she's always at everything. She lives in the community, so she comes to that. She's on the CCG committee, and I think it's a nice bridge to the CDC, because the two committees work collectively. It's just nice to have somebody that's in the community coming to that committee, that the committee members there all live in Port Alberni, one in Vancouver. So I think she has a lot to contribute. So I'm excited for her to join the committee. There's a lot of on the side stuff that happens with the Children and Family Services, meaning not with the department, but I get a lot of citizens that approach me about their situations and whatnot, which I just point them to that, to the department. But they like to share, and I share with Kathy when I've had citizens approach me. That's just an interesting one. Coral is also I've spent a lot of time with Coral. Health isn't my portfolio, but she's able to, I mean, everybody talks to Coral as well. And so she's able to fill in blanks. I mean, I went from, like John, I had to learn about fish. And that was my focus, learning about fish. Now I've gone into citizen development, which is completely different from treaty implementation. So it's been a huge learning learning curve for me, but a good one. But there's lots of goodies there. And my citizenship. We meet monthly. We don't have a huge amount of applicants. We've had a couple of stickler ones, which we've stick handled through Executive Council, and then the other ones have gone back for more. I think it's the same problem that's happened before, is just information isn't being completely filled out accurately on the forms. We did have Jeff come and sit in, or not sit in, but speak to the committee. Is it the last one?
Yeah.
And talk about filling in the forms accurately, which the committee is pretty vocal about. And then we had Melinda come in and speak to the committee again, but we have a new committee member of looking at amendments to the Citizenship Act. And it was interesting when Jeff came in, the things he raised with the committee is pretty much what the committee was already looking at. So now it's moving to the next stage, now that we've met with Melinda, to the Public Council, and hopefully we'll get some action on getting that worked up. But it seemed like we've lost.
I think I want to excuse myself from the meeting. Our family is being put on alert with my mom. We were supposed to meet tomorrow, but I've just got a note that I should call ASAP. Maybe we take a break tomorrow.